Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick here. It's late here, 1 o'clock in the morning, but I'm still on the path that the Lord would have me on tonight, trying to get this video made for His glory. And it's the indictment of the Laodicean church. The indictment of the Laodicean church. What is the Laodicean church? It's the end times lukewarm church. I'm going to read the text in a minute. But first, I want to lay the groundwork here. In John chapter 1, verse 1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And then on down in John chapter 1, it says, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld His glory, the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Jesus Christ is the Word of God. The Logos is the Greek word. The Logos, Word of God. When someone gets a word from God, or a quickened word of God, it's a rhema. A rhema word from God. A now word. But the Word of God, or even the Bible, is called the Logos. And Jesus is the Word of God. I want you to keep that in mind. I want to do a little bit of history of the world and the history of the redemption of man. But let me just read Revelation chapter 14. And unto the angel of the church of Laodicea write, these things saith the Amen, the faithful and the true witness, the beginning of the creation of God. I know thy works, that thou art neither cold nor hot. I would thou wert hot or cold. I wish you were either hot or cold. So then, because you are lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will spew thee out of my mouth. Because thou sayest, I am rich and increased with goods and have need of nothing, and knoweth not that thou art wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked. I counsel thee to buy of me gold tried in the fire, that thou mayest be rich, and white raiment or clothes, that thou mayest be clothed, that the shame of thy nakedness do not appear, and anoint thy eyes with eye salve, that thou mayest see us. As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be jealous, therefore, and repent. Behold, I stand at the door of the church and knock. I added that part of the church. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come into him and sup with him, and him with me. To him that overcometh, I will grant to sit with me in my throne, even as I also overcame and sat down with my Father in his throne. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith to the churches. First off, what I wanted to say before I give this little history lesson is Jesus said, he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith to the church. Now we got the Word, and then we got the Spirit, the Holy Spirit speaking to people. Now that's the problem, number one, with the Laodicean church. They don't want to hear anything about the Holy Spirit and what the Holy Spirit has to say. God still speaks. Is God still writing the Bible today? No. There's a whole different thing of the canon of Scripture. The Logos, as I mentioned, the Logos. Jesus is the Logos, the Word of God. A rhema word is a word from the Word that lines up with the Word. God is still speaking by His Spirit. But the problem is people don't have an ear to hear. The Bible says the Word brings death, but the Spirit brings life. So just like I made a video earlier, just a few minutes ago, the Holy Spirit is what quickens the Word. You can read the Bible all day long. The Bible says it is spiritually discerned. You cannot understand the Bible without the Holy Spirit helping you, comforting you, guiding you. He's the comforter. He's the guide. Equal with Jesus. Jesus said, I'll send you another comforter. Jesus was a comforter, and the Holy Spirit is a comforter. Just equal to the Lord Jesus Christ Himself. And the Holy Spirit is the one who calls us to remembrance of the Word of God. You cannot operate according to the Word without the Holy Spirit. The Bible says it is spiritually discerned. So how can all these Holy Spirit blasphemers, as I mentioned, the most one in the news right now, John MacArthur, as an example, Holy Spirit blasphemers say they know Jesus and don't know the Holy Spirit? Well, that's impossible, because Jesus said, no man comes to me unless the Father draws them. Only by the revelation of the Holy Spirit. What does Jesus tell us in John chapter 14? The Holy Spirit brings conviction of sin to the world. The Holy Spirit is the one working in the earth now. Jesus is seated at the right hand of the Father, ever making intercession for us. Of course, the Father is in heaven. Who's on earth? God, the Holy Spirit, is on earth right now, moving in this world, bringing about the knowledge of sin and death into the hearts and minds of men as the Word has been preached. Men proclaim the Word. The Holy Spirit takes that Word, convicts the heart of the sinner. convicts the heart of Christians to repent, the backslidden to return unto me, and I'll return unto you, says the Lord. Let's have a history lesson, brothers and sisters. This is the indictment of the Laodicean church. Number one, they don't have an ear to hear. That's the problem. Those who do have an ear to hear, they listen to what the Spirit says to the church. And the word from the Lord Jesus Christ, repent. He's talking to the churches, all those churches there except for Philadelphia. Jesus says to those churches, repent. They're already supposedly Christians, and he says to repent. Don't believe the lie of what I call greasy gracers. Don't believe the lie of these people that tell you, oh, you can say a prayer and Jesus, I believe you down the cross and that's it. Live your life any way you want. Bear no fruit. Do anything you want. And hey, you're going to heaven. The Bible tells us that faith without works is dead. John the Baptist said, bear fruit in keeping with repentance. What did Jesus do when he went into Jerusalem? People love to talk about it as faith. Have faith in God. Jesus said, Mark chapter 11, verse 22, have faith in God. You know, say, whomsoever shall say to this mountain, be thou removed and cast into the sea, not doubt in his heart, but believe those things, whatever he saith, he shall have whatsoever he saith. You know, people love to quote that part, especially in the, you know, in Pentecostal circles. But the question is that people don't answer or ask is, why did Jesus curse the fruit tree? Why did he curse it? In the natural, he cursed it because it didn't have no fruit on it. But what's the point? There's lots of trees that aren't doing a good job because he was illustrating metaphorically that Israel has not bear any fruit. Therefore, it's been cursed. And that's a fact. Now, Israel will be restored, and they're in the process of being restored, and God will deal with them during the 70th week of Daniel during the tribulation period. Okay? But there's Israel was shut down. The 69th week of Daniel ended on the day of what people call Palm Sunday, when Jesus had his triumphal entry into Jerusalem. The clock stopped for the nation of Israel. Read Romans chapter 9 through 11, that the day is coming when they'll all be saved in a day when the Lord Jesus Christ returns at the end of the tribulation. Israel will be saved in a day, and they will accept Jesus as the Messiah. Zechariah chapter 12, verse 10, they will mourn for the one they pierced. Zechariah chapter 14, it says, who is this that, where did you get these wounds? And he says, I was wounded in the house of my friends. Zechariah chapter 14, when the Lord Jesus Christ returns. There's lots of other verses. I just quoted a few. Let's go back to this, brothers and sisters. Let's go back to the Garden of Eden. This is the indictment of the Laodicean church. And this is just a church history. I don't want to get... There's the greasy gracers, and then there's the Israeli people who worship Israel as a god. And that's extremes. All these different extremes. Judaizers who try to put the law on the Gentiles when we see it's all settled in Acts chapter 15. The grace of the New Testament is a fulfillment of the law. As a matter of fact, Romans chapter 10. I was just reading that today. The Lord keeps giving me text after text after text. And, you know, I don't know, but I, you know, the Lord gave me this, you know, this ministry. It's not my ideas or my choice or what, but to preach the Word of God. See, I wasn't even going to look at this text. I'm trying to get something else here. But the Lord has said, arrested me to look at Romans chapter 10. Now I'm looking at it just like without even thinking in advance here. People love to use Romans chapter 10 to talk about salvation. Romans chapter 10, verse 9 and 10. Confess with your mouth and believe in your heart, Jesus Christ is the Lord, and God is raised from the dead, thou shalt be saved. But this whole text of Romans chapter 9, 10, 11, you want us to hear about Israel and the church and all that? Read Romans 9, 10, and 11. You can get a good idea. Let's see. Look at this one. This is what I was just looking at. The Lord led me to today. I didn't know it was going to be part of this message. Romans chapter 10, verse 1. Brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they might be saved. Israel's not saved. They rejected the Messiah. For I bear them record that they have a zeal for God, but not according to knowledge. For they being ignorant of God's righteousness. Hello, all you Israeli worshipers. And Paul wasn't a fake calling himself a Jew and was not on YouTube. He really was of the tribe of Benjamin, not a fake wannabe Jew on YouTube. For them being ignorant of God's righteousness and going about to establish their own righteousness, have not submitted themselves unto the righteousness of God. Verse 4, attention Judaizers, for Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone that believeth. For Moses described the righteousness which is of the law, that the man which doeth those things shall live by them. But the righteousness which is of, this has got the study notes right in the middle of the verse. But this righteousness which is of faith speaketh on this wise. Say not in thy heart, who shall ascend to heaven, bring Christ down. That's where he goes on to say, but what does it say? What does this righteousness of faith say? The word is nigh thee. Verse 8, even in thy mouth and in thy heart, that is the word of faith which we preach, that if you confess with your mouth that the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thine heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. That's the righteousness that cometh by faith. The whole book of Romans is all about faith. From the very beginning to the end, it's built right up. It's known as the capital letter of the New Testament. Actually, 1 Corinthians is too. Romans and 1 Corinthians is known as the capital letters of, lays out the theology of the whole New Testament. And all covers all bases. Books of Acts, we see it played out in the real world as a historical narrative. Anyway, brothers and sisters, back to where I was trying to go, and then the Lord wanted me to add that on there. In the beginning, Eve, under the direction of Adam, Adam heard the word of God. Remember what I said in the beginning? Jesus is the word of God. Now, God gave his word to Adam and said, hey, you got one law, one rule. Do not eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Now, Adam told Eve, you know, they walk with God in the cool of day and talk with him. Maybe God even discussed it again with Adam and Eve, and it's not recorded in the Bible. But Eve knew, because when the serpent asked her about it, she said, yeah, God said don't eat it. And then she even added her own part and said, he said don't even touch it. Don't even touch it. You know, so then Satan said, oh, did God really say that? And it won't really hurt you. God just doesn't want you to become like him, you know. The day you eat of it, you'll become like God. When God said the day you eat of it, you'll surely die. You know, and they did. As one day with the Lord, with us, as a thousand years, with us, as one day with the Lord. Adam and Eve died. You know, Adam died at 900 something years old. No man lived past 1,000 years, which is one day with the Lord. Methuselah lived to be the oldest, 969 years old. He was the oldest. No man lived to be over one day in the counting of God, 1,000 years with man. Anyway, Eve rejected, listen to this, Eve rejected the word of God. God gave a word, don't eat this. Eve, as a type of the church, as a type of Israel, she rejected the word. That's what I've been reading too about Romans now. That's the next step, talking about Israel. So the bride, Eve, I know that there's someone just recently, Steve DeNoon, made a video, and I haven't had time to watch any videos on the internet slow, so a little bit of his about Eve. And he was talking about something else. But I'm talking about this right now. Eve rejected the word of God. Don't eat from the fruit of the tree. Instead, she decided to follow Satan. She ate the fruit of the tree. It's like the Kabbalists do. The Kabbalist tree thing they have, tree of knowledge of good and evil. The root of the New Age movement is Kabbalism, as in this Rabbi Keturah. Anyway, most evil thing on earth that will produce the Antichrist, that will produce the one world religion, will come from Kabbalism. Watch and see. That's the root of the New Age movement, the tree of knowledge. So Eve decided to take that. She rejected the word of God. Then what happened? Let's just do the short version of this story. Then the Hebrew bride, Israel, Jesus came, the word of God came again. And just like Eve, Israel said, no. The Hebrew bride that some people are exalting as a god said, no, we reject. We reject the one word that God gave us. God didn't give us 100 words. He gave one word, don't eat the fruit of the tree. He gave one way to heaven. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. God gave one word, Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus the Christ, Jesus the Messiah. That's the only word he gave. And Israel rejected the word of God, Jesus Christ, and had him turned over to Pontius Pilate to be crucified. The only reason why the Romans crucified him, because the Jews in that time were not allowed to give the death penalty to anybody. And the Bible prophesied that Jesus would be pierced. He'd be crucified before crucifixion was even invented. King David wrote, and I believe it's Psalm 2 or Psalm 22. I always get those backwards, that they pierce my hands and feet. You know, the bulls of Bashan encompass around me, and they mock me and all this. It's straight while Jesus' thoughts on the cross. My God, why have thou forsaken me? It's all in that psalm. Hundreds of years before crucifixion was even invented. So he was turned over to be crucified by the Romans to fulfill the word of God. And the Israelis were not able to crucify or, you know, to stone anybody. During that period of time, it was against law for them to give someone the death penalty. Later on, by the time they stoned Stephen, they had been given that right. But during the time, historically, and as they said, they couldn't give anybody the death penalty. Only the Romans could during that season at the time of Jesus. Of course, God wanted it that way because he wanted to be crucified. So the Gentiles would have a hand in it also. So Jesus died for the whole world, not just one people, but the whole world. As it said, he didn't die for their sins only, but the sins of the whole world. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. Who should ever believe in him would not perish, but have everlasting life. So they rejected the word of God. Okay, so that's history. There's all these people who want to get caught up and talking about what happened 2,000 years ago, what happened 6, 10,000 years ago with Eve. That's just a history lesson to give you a type of what's going on today. So all you Gentiles out there, stop worrying and trying to wear a prayer shawl and trying to do all this stuff. Because righteousness, if righteousness could come by the law and by the blood of bulls and goats, then the blood of Jesus is in vain. And the blood of Jesus is of none effect. And the blood of Jesus is a mockery. If the blood of bulls and goats can do anything for you under the law of Moses, as I just read from you from Romans chapter 10, verse 4, that Jesus Christ is the end of the law. And Moses taught a law that was not by the righteousness of faith, but the righteousness of faith is what Abraham had. Before there ever was a law, all those people saying that Abraham was under the law and all this stuff. No, he wasn't. The law didn't come out till... Look, this is what the letters of the New Testament is about. Romans chapter 4. You arguing against the word of God. Now, as soon as you start saying that you reject the writings of the Apostle Paul as something that doesn't belong in the Bible, well, hey, you've crossed the line and you are not a Christian. You're a heretic and an apostate. Now, that's just the bottom line. This is the canonized word of God. And that's what it is. You want to start taking out the parts of the Bible you don't want and pick and choose? Like I said, I've made many videos preaching that we're saved by grace without touching the letters of Paul, just to try to bend over backwards to win a few Judaizers to the Lord Jesus Christ, to give them the opportunity to see the error of their way, to rely on self-righteousness. That's what Paul's talking about. It's the righteousness of their own works. Not the righteousness that comes by faith. Romans chapter 10, what we just read. The indictment of the Laodicean church. Now this day, this lukewarm church, now in the real city of Laodicea, they had water that came in these aqueducts. And Romans put aqueducts everywhere. Okay, there was aqueducts that brought water in. Now that water had come from a hot spring in another town. I forgot the name of the town, it doesn't matter. But when that water got there, it was no longer hot, and it wasn't cold. It was lukewarm. So there was a real water in the aqueduct that came to the city of Laodicea that was literally actually lukewarm. And that's why Jesus was comparing them to actually the water in the city is lukewarm. So, you know, that's a great piece of information, but the point is not those things that you might hear about those things. That's great. But the reality is Jesus was saying they're neither hot nor cold, and he's going to spew them out of their mouth. That's the end times church. You think you're rich, but you're not. You're poor, blind, and naked. You do not have on a white raiment. Jesus said, I ask you to, you know, challenge you to buy from me gold tried in the fire and white raiment. What is he talking about? Righteousness. You're naked. You know, you're just like Adam and Eve. Going back to where I started with Adam and Eve, you're just like Adam and Eve in the garden. They're naked. They tried to cover themselves with a fig leaf. You know, they tried to provide their own covering. And that's what these Judaizers are doing. Those of you who are trying to walk in, follow the law and self-righteousness, you're putting a fig leaf on yourself. And guess what? How long do you think a fig leaf lasts before it turns brown and falls off? It ain't going to last long. And it doesn't cover up a whole lot either. Now, some of y'all might be plenty. Some other people, it's not. God himself sacrificed animals and put the animal skins on them to signify the way whereby he might remove their sins and cover our sins. In the law, the sacrifice of animals, all the way down through the Old Testament. It's all symbolic of the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. Now, the Laodicean church, I still haven't gotten to them. What they've done. Just like Eve, the mother of all things living, who rejected the word of God. The Hebrew bride, the Hebrew first bride of the Father, rejected the word of God. And now the Laodicean church has rejected the Lord Jesus Christ. All the denominations, almost 100%, they do. Let's just talk. The Protestant movement, when I say Protestant, I mean the Presbyterians, Lutherans, Methodists, and all those people. They deny the virgin birth. They've totally, not even nowhere near being part of the body of Christ anymore. Totally out in left field. The Baptists and Pentecostals and all them, they're not even preaching the gospel anymore. It's becoming more and more watered down where you've got this saddleback Chrislam stuff going on. Imagine this. You want to know who's going to go in the rapture? And I made lots of videos about this. Let's talk about the rapture. Because there is the bride that will escape. If you, now a lot of you guys are women, okay, but it would apply alternatively as to your husband. What would you do if you went to go on the day of your wedding with your bride or your groom, if you're a woman, and you found your future spouse in the bed with someone else? You came, knocked on the door, boom, boom, there's your bride in the bed with another man, or your groom in the bed with another man. What would you say? Well, that's what, when we start reading the prophets in the Old Testament, we see that Israel played the whore, played the harlot, as King James says, went a whoring with the religions of the other world, with the Egyptians, with the Babylonians, with all this, that's where this Kabbalism comes from Babylon. Same thing as like the Egyptian mystery religions. It goes back to the Tower of Babel, to Babylon, to Nimrod. They go a-whoring, mixing in false doctrine and idolatry and all this stuff, like the golden calves. Well, guess what? That's what the church is doing. Christendom. People keep talking about the Roman Catholicism. Now, we know about all the pomp and circumstance and pageantry and idolatry, and then the Pope walking around dressed like a king, and then there's Jesus born in a manger. There's John the Baptist walking around in, you know, camel's hair and eating, you know, wild honey and locust, and then here's the Pope living in the castle like a, you know, the greatest king on earth. The opposite of what the Lord Jesus Christ did, the opposite of what his prophets did. We know that. I'm talking about all the Protestant churches. I'm talking about the Baptist churches. I'm talking about the Pentecostal churches. They've gone a-whoring. They've gone a-whoring. You talk about Rome, you're the daughters of Rome. Same thing. Same spirit of whoredom, of harlotry, is upon the Laodicean church. Now, that's the problem. It's that it's adultery, spiritual adultery. The greatest sin in the Bible is spiritual adultery. And that is what the church has been doing. There, when the Lord comes, he finds those who are faithful to him, who are chastened to him. It says, talk about the virgins. You know, people talk about the wise and the foolish virgins, but they're virgins. They're chastened unto the Lord. They don't have any other gods before them. And this video is just the beginning. I'm just scratching the surface of the Laodicean church. Just scratching the surface. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith to the church. You know, I'm sorry, brothers and sisters, it's you know, I'm looking at laying out these things, boom, 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 and then I have this group of people. You know, I have to address each group, and I'll tell you why, brothers and sisters. I'll tell you why. I know there's, you know, lots of you guys who watch my video. You know, there's only one or two negative comments. I praise the Lord that I have a small amount of negative comments, because I'm laying all of these foundations to build that box, to put this Jezebel spirit in a box. Now, there are dozens of people who have messaged me and said, Brother Patrick, I got free from the Judaizers because of your videos. Brother Patrick, I got free of being a greasy gracer, and I rededicated my life, and then I received the baptism of the Holy Spirit and all this from watching your videos. And I have to keep laying the foundation, brothers and sisters. I thank you for your patience. There's people that never watched my videos before. This is the first time they've seen it. And I've got to keep laying that foundation. I got to hit all of those points, brothers and sisters. I don't, you know, even if it's just one person that hears it and says, hey, I never thought about that. I only heard this one-sided junk from somebody like John MacArthur. Hey, wait a minute. I never thought about that he's blaspheming the Holy Spirit. Wow, that's true, because that's what the Bible says. He's attributing the works of the Holy Spirit to the devil. That's blaspheming the Holy Spirit. Hey, wait a minute. Jesus said that's the unforgivable sin. Hey, thank you. I never thought of it that way. You're welcome. Thank the Lord. God is the one who's, given me the words to say for His glory. You know, and I just, it's late at night. It's after 1 o'clock in the morning. I love you guys. I've got to go on an on-fire version of this by the grace of God. I already touched on lots of this stuff in the past. And I just want you guys to see that there's nothing new under the sun, as King Solomon said in Ecclesiastes. There's nothing new. What Eve did rejecting the word, Israel rejected the word, and then all this Christendom, even starting with the Nicene Council, there's a rejection of the word of God, sola scriptorium. Even Martin Luther, when he came back to sola scriptorium, you know, there's still parts of the word that was rejected. You know, they said the just shall live by faith, but they did reject these other parts. Sanctification and holiness and all this. Then John Wesley and them came along and said, hey, I've made videos about this in the past, I'll go through it. They said, you know, God restored the holiness, sanctification to the church through John Wesley. Oh, the Baptists and all them had a fit, they didn't want to hear it. You know, and then the Baptists, of course, was used by God to restore. That baptism means to submerge in water, to be buried with Christ and rise again with Him. Clearly that's what happened in the Bible. Clearly that's what it says when Jesus came up out of the water. It also says, like I said, that we're buried with Christ and resurrected with Him when we're baptized. Sprinkling water on somebody's head is not symbolic of burying them under the ground. Of course, it's submersion in the water and coming back up. And of course, to be baptized after you're saved. All of these things were slowly restored, but yet there are other parts, like the baptism of the Holy Spirit was rejected. You know, and so God has been restoring His church, and there's always just those wise virgins in each movement. Each movement, we see the wise virgins. God has His people in all of these churches, and that is the greatest thing and the miracle about YouTube and about the internet. I have people who watch me who are really true born-again Christians who are in every denomination, even though their denominations are so wacky and so bad with a lesbian bishop in charge of their denomination, for whatever reason, either A, God is keeping them there as a witness against those evil people, or B, the Lord told them to leave and they haven't left yet. I don't know. Every person's different. Some people have a calling to be that salt and light. You know, God has His witnesses everywhere. So, anyway, brothers and sisters, it's late at night, so I will cut this off, but by the grace of God, I will continue with this video tomorrow and add on to this indictment of the Laodicean church, the indictment from the Lord of the end times church. The Lord has something against this Laodicean church and its spiritual adultery, sleeping with the enemy, finding themselves as concubines to the devil and his doctrines. God bless you guys. Let's set the captives free. That's what Jesus came to set the captives free. This is not You know, I want to add this on there. There's people, when they get convicted of sin, sometimes people, instead of repenting and becoming humble, they get mad and carry on. But in actuality, Jesus wants them to repent. Why would, and that's what, you know, Jesus said in the letter to all these letters except for Philadelphia. He said to repent. In other words, it's not like throwing stones at people or condemning you, tell me, oh, blah, blah, blah. It's saying, hey, repent or you're going to hell. Repent or you're going to hell. Turn or burn, as they say. I mean, that's what it's about. It's a call to repentance. It's not condemnation. People get condemnation and call to repentance confused. And if they're mad about what they hear and they don't want to repent, they don't want to accept it, well, then of course they say, you're condemning me. But if they hear it, and you know, there's lots of people hear it and say, wow, like I mentioned earlier, hey, wow, I never thought about that. That when I say that speaking in tongues is from the devil, hey, I might be blaspheming the Holy Spirit. I need to repent of that and tell the Lord I was doing it in ignorance. I didn't know better. You know, that kind of thing. That's what it's about. God bless you guys. Love you.